The next item of business is a debate on motion 10917 in the name of Neil Bibby on supporting Scotland's culture sector. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Neil Bibby to speak to and move the motion for around 6 minutes. Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour has brought forward this debate today because we recognise and revere the enormous contribution the arts and culture sector makes to Scotland's national life. As Professor Geoffrey Sharkey, the principal of the Royal Conservatoire, recently put it, artists are the connectors, creators and envoys of Scotland within our communities and across the world. The sector is important to our society and to our economy too. The creative industry is worth nearly £4.5 billion. It supports 80,000 jobs. The arts and culture sector punches massively above its weight in our economy. Its contribution also to brand Scotland and our image around the world cannot be overstated. Our artists, writers, performers, directors, producers, creators and so many more who support them should be the pride of Scotland. We owe them a debt of gratitude. And yet, Presiding Officer, this is a sector at breaking point after years of underfunding, and what has the Scottish Government's response been to date? At the start of this year, the Scottish Government threatened to cut £6.6 million, that is equivalent to 10% from Creative Scotland's funds in the budget for 2023-2024. On the 21st of February this year, the SNP did a U-turn to much fanfare and cancelled their proposed cut. But in late September, just 7 months later, the Cabinet Secretary disgracefully did a U-turn on the U-turn and confirmed the £6.6 million cut was going ahead after all. This was met with a furious response, and no wonder, it was a serious betrayal of trust. Since then, the Cabinet Secretary was unequivocal on the 5th of October with me when given a gold-plated assurance that the money will be restored next year. But people in the sector are asking now, what is the commitment worth when previous promises were broken? I say to the Cabinet Secretary, a promise is a promise, and it should be kept this year. That is in order for this government to start rebuilding trust with the sector and avert a looming crisis to stop job losses and venues closing. Presiding Officer, the government have clearly been feeling the heat on this thanks to the work of the Campaign for Arts, Culture Counts, Musicians Union, Equity and so many others. And that pressure is why we had the First Minister's announcement on arts and culture funding at SNP conference last week. The Cabinet Secretary challenged me earlier today to welcome that announcement. And we do welcome that statement of intent. And a statement of intent is all it is at this stage. But we welcome it given the parlous state of the sector and on the basis there is a clear delivery plan. But what we do not welcome broken promises. We do not welcome the cut this year, which risks organisations going to the wall who are having to submit their applications today to Creative Scotland, and we won't welcome more baseless promises. So today's debate is an opportunity for the Cabinet Secretary to cancel his cut this year and to set out details of the announcement and answer a series of questions. I start with a question he failed to answer earlier. Why is the government stating that it is doubling the arts and culture budget by £100 million when the existing budget appears to be £175 million? People in the sector deserve to know what is and what is not included. Does it include the national performing companies? How will £100 million be distributed over the next 5 years? And where is the funding coming from? How much of this funding will actually materialise in the upcoming budget? And when will a timeline outlining when decisions on distribution of funding be published? I'm happy to give way to the Cabinet Secretary now if he wishes to answer those questions, or perhaps he will want to answer it when he takes the floor in a moment's time, because it is essential that the government provides answers and clarity, not just to restore trust, but to give certainty. I was happy to take an intervention from the Cabinet Secretary. We were requesting details from Mr Brown, no offence meant to you there. Presiding Officer, let me tell you why the Chamber needs that clarity and why that's needed. This Parliament has heard time and time again pleas from the sector that is crying out for help. Vocal have told us the level of publicly funded cultural service provision has been depleted to the most basic level. Artlink have said the current financial settlement is having a devastating effect. Museums Gallery Scotland have warned of a hollowing out of museum services. Prospects say we're at breaking point. The Federation of Scottish Theatres said that a continued lack of public investment may result in what could very easily be seen as a willful demise of the cultural sector as we know it. Equity, who protested outside this building, have warned their national reputation is diminished with further cuts to support and funding. And even Creative Scotland has warned many organisations are at risk of insolvencies and redundancies. Presiding officer, the picture painted is one of increased costs and chronic standstill funding. Many organisations are on their knees. Combined with the pandemic and the cost of living crisis, it is a perfect storm. Stability, security and the ability to plan ahead are vital to the sector. Presiding officer, the Scottish Government is to refresh its culture strategy, but it's clear there is a huge gulf between the levels of ambition and the levels of investment coming from the Government. That is the very definition of setting up this entire sector to fail. In closing, Presiding Officer, the Government should keep its promise not to cut Creative Scotland's budget this year and give the sector the funding, the certainty, the confidence and the backing it needs. Over to you, Cabinet Secretary. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Bibby. I can advise the Chamber there is no time in hand and that will be ruthlessly enforced. I now call on Angus Robertson to speak to and move Amendment 10917.2. Cabinet Secretary, up to 5 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I begin by moving the amendment that stands in my name and also apologise to you in the Chamber that exceptionally, owing to the change in parliamentary business timings, I will not be present at the close of the debate, and I am particularly grateful for the understanding of circumstances by Neil Bibby, who is moving today's motion, who I commend, incidentally, for bringing forward today's debate, if not the motion, which can't bring itself to welcome a doubling in planned culture spending. I fully appreciate that this is an incredibly challenging time for the sector, enduring the shocks of Brexit fallout, of the pandemic, the energy crisis, and the mismanagement of the economy by the UK government, which has sent prices spiralling. From the first day in office, I've been in discussions with both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister on how the Scottish Government can best support the sector in navigating this perfect storm. And I'd like to put on record my appreciation for their understanding and their support. The First Minister's announcement last week not only responds to these pressures, but signals our ambition. The Scottish Government will more than double our investment in Scotland's art and culture by £100 million over the next 5 years. We have committed, I'll make a bit of progress if he doesn't mind, we've committed to increasing opportunities for participation in creative pursuits, in supporting the protection of new works and ensuring Scotland's cultural output has platforms at home and abroad. We know the sector welcomes the news. I can quote David Gregg of Edinburgh's Lyceum Theatre as an example, who said, "This is a seriously important intervention at a crucial moment. This investment," he went on to say, "is to the benefit of all Scots as we build on our theatre, film, art, literature and gaming industries, which are world class." I couldn't agree more with him, and I'm delighted that this Scottish Government has committed to doubling spending on culture and the arts. I give way.
Craig Hoy.
Cabinet Secretary, for giving way, is Mr Robertson aware that the future of the Lammermuir Festival in East Lothian is in doubt after Creative Scotland withdrew all funding from the programme this year? And when I spoke with Creative Scotland earlier this month, they said that they were facing the double whammy of cuts to their own budget and increased requests from arts and music bodies, hit hard by the withdrawal of funding from councils, themselves subject to swinging SNP real-time cuts. Isn't it the case that what Scotland's arts and heritage organisations
cabinet
need is co-funding today
cabinet
and not headline grabbing promises for tomorrow?
Cabinet Secretary.
So if the member had been here for culture questions earlier, he would have heard my answer. I encourage him to read it in the official report, having taken so much time from me in this afternoon's debate. Colleagues across the chamber will appreciate the complex funding landscape for arts and culture, and funding is provided by the Scottish Government, local government and by philanthropy. Even within the Scottish Government, culture is funded through a variety of means. To Creative Scotland, our public body for the arts and creative industries, including the screen sector, and our targeted funds to support key areas, including youth music and festivals, and our national performing companies funded directly by the Scottish Government. I have to make some progress. I have so little time. I'm sure Mr. Bibby wants me to answer the questions he's already asked. Due diligence and consideration are needed to ensure this increase in funding over the next 5 years is directed for maximum impact. The priorities for this increased investment will be taken forward in line with the Scottish Government's upcoming Culture Strategy Action Plan refresh. And I welcome input from all in the sector and invite them to get in touch. For now, I can say the increase will start from next year, with further detail to be set out in the upcoming budget through established processes. I appreciate that the sector is very concerned about what Scottish funding and support looks like this year, and I have to put in context that over the last 5 years, the Scottish Government has provided over £33 million to Creative Scotland to compensate for the shortfall in National Lottery funding. As a result of rising costs and pressures on budget across government, we are unable to make up the ongoing shortfall this year. So I agreed with Creative Scotland Board that they will use their National Lottery reserves to ensure that all regularly funded organisation payments are met in full, as provided for in the 23-24 funding agreement. This will mean that the regularly funded organisations will not receive reduced funding this financial year. As mentioned, spending on culture by the Scottish Government extends far beyond Creative Scotland. We're investing £278 million in Scotland's culture and heritage sector in 23-24. Projects such as the Youth Music Initiative, with £9.5 million committed this year, have made a huge impact in helping young people across Scotland to access music making and develop their wider skills and learning. I commend the Scottish Government amendment to the Chamber this afternoon. It supports the Scottish Government's plan to more than double arts and culture funding by £100 million over the next 5 years. It endorses the Scottish Government's aim of working with the culture sector to implement a refreshed culture strategy action plan, and it believes that the UK Government should match this stated ambition and at least double its investment in arts and culture over the same period. If this Chamber supports a doubling in spending on the arts and culture, they will vote for the Government's amendment this afternoon. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Alexander Stewart to speak to and move Amendment 10917.1 up to 4 minutes. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be opening on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I move the amendment in my name. Today's motion rightly speaks about the importance of the arts and culture sector and the numerous challenges it faces, which has only been exacerbated because of what the SNP government have been doing. And as such, these benches will be happy to support Labour's motion today. In his recent party conference, the First Minister made a number of warm words about the Scottish culture sector. He spoke about Scotland being rich in culture and the arts, and about how it was so important to go far beyond just the economic impact. Such words would have been very welcome if only they matched the Scottish Government's record on the issue, Presiding Officer, which have been one of continual leaving the sector short of funding that it's crying out for. The additional arts and culture funding announcement by the First Minister in his speech is welcomed, but let us not forget, however, that it's only been a few weeks since the SNP U-turn on its own U-turn and reimposed the £7 million nearly cuts on the budget that was imposed. To say that the sector has been left struggling to trust this government would be a major understatement, Presiding Officer. Speaking about the issue, the CEO of Creative Scotland said, "It's an erosion of faith and trust. People are exhausted trying to keep the show on the road, literally." There is also a complete lack of clarity as to where and when this newly announced funding will be distributed. On the issue of the sector has been left with more questions than answers, and the campaign for the arts warned about funding needs to be put in place quickly in order to ensure that jobs will not be lost in the sector. Presiding Officer, as we are the potential job losses, my amendment speaks about the need for this government to take a more proactive approach towards protecting the arts and culture sector in Scotland. As my amendment suggests, 2,000 jobs and 26,000 opportunities are at risk from the Scottish Government does not implement and be a more proactive approach to protecting the arts, music and culture sector in Scotland. This could be achieved by the introduction of an arts bill which should be introduced a more sustainable and long-term financial planning model. Scotland's creative industries contribute £5 billion to the Scottish economy every year. Yep. It's also so important that the sector is able to properly plan the finances for its future. The recent fiasco around the Creative Scotland's funding has demonstrated the need for multi-year certainty around budgets. This would give the clarity, the organisations, and greater security for the employees, which they, as I say, are crying out for. In conclusion, if there is to be one thing that should be taken from this debate today, it is that the government's record on this issue is not one of empowerment, presiding officer. Rather, it is one of non-committal and uncertainty. That non-committal and that uncertainty continues. Sector organisations up and down the length and breadth of this country are struggling to come to terms with what the actual government says in one word and then does in another. They are not supporting the sector. They are leaving the sector to look after itself. If it wasn't for, as we know, the reserves left in the Creative Scotland, then there would be massive cuts and massive job losses across. The Scottish Conservatives are committed to listening to the Scottish sector and ensuring and safeguarding the contributions to the society and to our economy. It is high time this government put the warm words in action to take the same approach, because by doing that, their approach will be, and we will see something happening in this sector and not seeing it continue to wither on the vine. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton up to 4 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the Labour Party for bringing this important debate to the Chamber today. I must say it's very timely. The playwright George Bernard Shaw once said that without art, the crudeness of reality would make the world unbearable, and on a daily basis we come up against the crude reality of our time. And Presiding Officer, when times are tough like this, it is easy for governments to lay the artistic and cultural sectors to one side, and in uncertain times as which we are living in, it is often public services that are crumbling around us that rightly take the focus of chambers like this. But arts will always play second fiddle to those other pressing concerns. But we dismiss the importance of the art and cultural sectors at our peril. They have a unique and crucial part to play, as we have heard several times today, in enlightening us, in unifying us, in supporting our mental health in what are increasingly anxious and fractious times. It is also important to remember that the creative industry is estimated to be worth £4.5 billion alone to the Scottish economy. It keeps 80,000 of our fellow Scots in work, a point which is often overlooked. We would also be remiss to overlook the positive impact it has in terms of attracting tourists to our shores. And it's no wonder the beauty of Scotland is advertised best in dramas like BBC's Shetland. Scotland has a proud cultural heritage as well as a growing film and TV industry that punches well above its weight on the international stage. It is baffling, then, that this SNP Green government has treated the sector so flippantly and with such great disrespect. Despite the fact that this sector was only just beginning to get back on its feet following the lockdown years, last December the government announced a £6.6 million cut to Creative Scotland's budget. That is a cut of 10%. It's been well rehearsed in the remarks already today. That very understandable uproar which followed this decision prompted the government to reverse that cut in February this year. But now, once again, we have a U-turn on a U-turn with the reinstating of this initial funding cut. First Minister's latest announcement at the SNP conference was no more than a cynical move aimed at garnering good headlines. This may seem like more than a joyless round of hokey-cokey, but it's had profound consequences for Creative Scotland, which has been forced to use up its cash reserves to cover that shortfall. The Chief Executive of Creative Scotland, Ian Munro, described the situation as, and I quote, trying to change the engines of an airplane while you are still flying it. The offhand way in which the Scottish Government is treating the arts industry is reminiscent of the way it has disregarded the business community as well. They need certainty in order to thrive, to grow, and also to safeguard those precious jobs. But on this government's watch, we have had the Edinburgh International Film Festival stripped back, almost ended, Edinburgh Film House closed and the building sold, and over 100 jobs lost. And now Screen Scotland is under pressure following these most recent cuts. Presiding Officer, the government are guilty of cultural vandalism, nothing more, nothing less. There are also large parts of Scotland that are being left entirely behind when it comes to cultural spending, which is largely geared towards our metropolitan areas. Rural and island communities just aren't getting their fair share. One example of this, and we have heard of this before, is Screen Machine, Scotland's only mobile cinema, which serves the Highlands and Islands. It's been running for 25 years, but it could be set to end next year if it fails to get the funding it needs for a new custom vehicle. The service currently relies on a French lease truck, and that lease expires in April. The group that runs it estimate their brand new Screen Machine will cost £1.4 million. It's asked the Scottish Government for 50% of that cut. I can think we can all agree that initiatives like this deserve our support, and that is why the Liberal Democrats will support the Labour motion today. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Polly McNeill to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Up to 4 minutes, please, McNeill.
Thank you. I am pleased that Scottish Labour have chosen the culture budget cuts for this opposition debate, because we do need to clear up some of the confusion in the sector over the recent announcements. Some of it has been cleared up today, but not all of it. The culture sector, as Alec Cole-Hamilton has said, has played a central role in Scotland's public life, has created international reputation of excellence, and indeed it characterises the Scottish nation as a country that's passionate about its music, its arts, its museums, and accounts for 80,000 jobs and a not insignificant £4.5 billion to the economy. But in February, the Scottish Government heralded its decision not to cut culture funding, but still have indicated a 10% cut to Creative Scotland's budget. They have not provided certainty for the workforce, a workforce that have been through so much in the pandemic, and in fact, many of us relied on the sector so much when we were at home, worried for our families, worried for our jobs. This is the sector we relied upon most. But not providing certainty for our workforce that have been through so much. And the national performing companies over the last 10 years have had a 20% real cut. The insecurity of the sector, of workers in the sector, is also high, higher than most, and the poor pay that does not conform to fair work objectives. We are way behind here in terms of where we ought to be. As said by Neil Bibby, Creative Scotland has said that of the 120 bodies that it regularly funds, up to one-third are at risk of insolvency and half are financially weak. This is not a strong position for this sector. Every key organisation has something quite striking to say. The hollowing out of services, the willful demise of the sector and breaking point. It could not actually be more bleak. But I do want to spend some time discussing the confusion that still reigns in the arts sector on the recent announcement. The £100 million, we do require clarity, therefore, as Neil Bibby has rightly welcomed this U-turn. So let's begin with that recognition. But as the Musicians' Union actually sets out pretty well, actually, in their briefing, here are the questions we do need to answer, or the government does need to answer. If this £100 million is meaningful and real, which budget lines have been included in the calculation to get to that £100 million? And what does the doubling of the budget mean actually within the sector? What does it mean for the National Performing Arts, for example? It's easy to make speeches at the conference, but it's harder to provide that funding and provide the certainty to the organisations. All they want to know is, where is the money? When is it coming? And how will this £100 million be distributed? Is there a timeline for the money? When will crucial decisions be made? Can you give us some indication of, well, you're shaking your head, Minister, but you can clarify this. I think something is unreasonable to say, well, this is great, but I think the sector would like some certainty, and I'd be delighted
You've to... You've got very little time, Cabinet Secretary.
Neil, agree that these kind of decisions need to go through the normal budgetary processes, yes or no?
Polly McNeill.
Well, why don't you give us a yes or no as to whether this is real money and whether or not when will we see some detail then? You could have answered you could have used your intervention
through the chair, please.
But you chose not to. Presiding officer, I will finish on that point. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, presiding officer. The Scottish Government is evidently committed to growing a more sustainable, diverse and impactful culture sector in Scotland. And given that the creative industries are worth billions to Scotland, supporting tens of thousands of jobs. The importance of this commitment has never been greater. And we're fortunate to live in a country with so many talented people, a unique and vibrant culture, which makes Scotland a desirable and diverse place to live, providing opportunity to grow the economy and create skilled jobs and successful businesses. The Scottish Government's dedication to fund arts for Scotland's young people, it cannot be overlooked, and I was pleased that the Cabinet Secretary actually talked about the Youth Music Initiative, which ensures that every school pupil in Scotland can access a year of free music tuition by the time they leave primary school, a very sound investment of £9.5 million a year. Happy to take an intervention.
Sarah Boyack.
I think several members have now commented that this £100 million does appear to be plucked out of the air. So, as convener of the Finance Committee, would you like to talk about how you think that
through
money
chair.
Should be allocated, budgeted, and the timescales revealed?
Kenneth Gibson.
Well, I would actually think that that would be set out in the draft budget, actually, as is normal. We're talking about a five-year investment starting from the spring of 2024 when the next financial year is. Now, regardless of what we do, you'll vote against the budget. We know that full well. But this is how the budget is actually done. You know, they will sit down and it will be put into the draft budget like any other spending lines. And I thought for someone who'd been here for so long, that would be fairly obvious. But Creative Scotland strives to ensure that funding delivers the widest possible public benefit across Scotland. But this has not always been the case, and even taking into account the fact that prestigious national companies such as Scottish Opera and Scottish Ballet are based in Glasgow, and a Cattle Tour 2 has an important role, not least through the Edinburgh Festival, other areas of Scotland, including Ayrshire, have received a disproportionately low share of Creative Scotland's funding, and it is important to encourage growth in these areas, and I do ask the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that funding is allocated fairly across all regions of Scotland, including rural and island regions that often face barriers to accessing the arts, and I thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for also raising that point. Amidst the unprecedented pandemic in which the culture and event sectors were amongst the worst affected, the Scottish Government delivered £256 million of support to creatives, many of whom were unable to earn a living during that time otherwise. Support provided by the £85 million COVID-19 Emergency Fund prevented 82% of Scottish organisations from cutting jobs or becoming insolvent, highlighting the Government's dedication to supporting the sector. And the Scottish Government's plan to more than double arts and culture funding by more than £100 million increase over the next 5 years is very welcome, and I'm astonished at the Grinch-like comments we've seen from the opposition as a result. I mean, talk about rejecting a solid increase in funding. I mean, it's absolutely astonishing. Reckless economic decisions, of course, made by the UK government undeniably created a perfect storm of long-term budget pressures, reduced income generation and increased operating costs, forcing the Scottish government to make difficult financial decisions. And the Tories really have some cheek talking about arts and culture, which they have completely eviscerated south of the border. So let's have no more crocodile tears in that regard. And we all know about the damage Brexit has done. I support calls in the UK government to seek visa and work permit free arrangements for Scots working in EU countries on a short term basis. Creatives in Scotland previously benefited from funding from Creative Europe, with a final round of funding equaling over €18 million now lost, because the UK government's shared prosperity fund has only offered a measly £7 million in replacement funding during its first year to Global Screen Fund, and maybe that's something the Tories should raise with their bosses down south. Had we remained in the EU, creative industries would have received an additional €184 million. So for as long as Labour joins with Tories in supporting Brexit, Scottish businesses and workers within the culture sector will financially suffer, given across the UK the arts have lost £200 million in arts and culture funding.
Conclude,
and lastly, I'll just make a plea for Screen Machine. Arlene Cumbrae and my constituency will benefit like many in the Highlands and Islands, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will help deliver additional
thank
funding.
Thank you.
For
I now call Jamie Hockler-Johnson to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Hockler-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One of the main characters of one of my favourite TV shows, the much-acclaimed The Wire, is the cigar-smoking, curmudgeonly Baltimore detective Bunk Moreland. And the actor who plays Moreland, Wendell Pierce, said culture was a form through which we as a society reflect on who we are, where we've been, where we hope to be. I'm very fortunate to represent a region, the Highlands and Islands, that rivals any in Scotland for the strength of its cultural offering. In fact, I would say it rivals anywhere in the world. And as well as being so important for us who live there, it attracts visitors from right across the globe. There are, of course, the well-known events up Heliar and Shetland, the St. Magnus International Festival in Orkney, the many local Highland Games, and of course the annual Royal National Mod, which celebrates our Gaelic linguistic and cultural heritage. But culture and the arts play a part in communities right across the Highlands and Islands, from local events to the smaller museums, which celebrate the diversity of my region. And they're supported by passionate and committed organisations and local volunteers, as well as by the work of charities and others. But there is real pressure on the sector, and it's not just because of the SNP's cuts to Creative Scotland, because local government also plays an important role. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary, when he was previous MP for Murray, will have visited the Faulkner Museum in Forres. Well, he wouldn't be able to visit today, because it was closed in April 2020 by Murray Council's previous SNP administration because of his SNP government's squeeze on local government funding. And I, with other Conservative MSP colleagues, have concerns over UHI's plans cuts to their history department. As a history graduate, and I recognise that history is so important to both understanding the past and inspiring the future. Understanding the past and valuing the past and learning from the mistakes of the past is vital, a principle which seems to have passed many in the SNP by. But would we expect anything less from a party which has, in the last year or so, mirrored some of the most popular of genres of TV culture? The SNP have moved from soap opera to police drama to comedy. Their leadership contest quickly descended from Succession into Game of Thrones. And now, with a new leader and his endless policy U-turns, including on arts funding, is more reminiscent of a pantomime. The SNP is stronger for Scotland, they claim. Oh, no, it isn't. Arts journalist Brian Ferguson described the funding cuts as the biggest betrayal of Scottish culture, artists and performers in modern times. And even the most loyal of the SNP's arts and culture loyalists recognise the blame falls squarely with SNP ministers in Edinburgh. Iona Fife accused the Scottish Government of flip-flopping on arts funding, arguing that workers in the culture sector have already lost faith in them. So what is the Scottish Government's response to these criticisms? Well, as exemplified by their cloth-eared amendment today, it's the usual and sadly predictable blame bingo. It's Brexit, it's COVID, it's the UK's fault. But of course it isn't. The blame lies squarely with SNP ministers in Edinburgh. Ministers who always seem to be able to find money down the back of the Bute House sofa when they need something for their own priorities, just not for culture, the arts. Presiding officer, both the Labour motion and the Scottish Conservative amendment highlight the uncertainty the SNP cuts is creating and the damage it's doing. There is the real threat to jobs, but we risk losing much more because our arts and culture binds together communities right across this country and it helps us reflect on who we are, where we've been and where we hope to be.
Thank you, Mr. Harcourt-Johnson. And I call Fazil Chowdhury to be followed by Keith Brown. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Chowdhury.
Presiding officer, the value of Scotland's culture sector cannot be denied. In Edinburgh alone, upwards of 3 million people flock to the capital every August for the festival. And yet, our cultural sector is in desperate need to help and support. Scotland is world-renowned for its culture and arts. But this legacy is in danger if the culture and arts sector continues to face lack of funding. Continued cuts following a difficult few years through the COVID-19 pandemic and cost of living crisis will see many key cultural institutions being lost if we do not step up and solve the problem. Edinburgh is feeling the brunt of this lack of culture funding. Last year, we saw the closure of the legendary film house in Edinburgh after its parent company went into administration. I was happy to hear the news that the film house may be reopened due to crowdfunding. And I am hopeful that we will see this great cultural institution restored. However, this is still just one example of the bleak future our cultural institutions may have. More recently, we have Lammermuir Festival, whose funding application was turned down by Creative Scotland last month. The grant was expected to make up 23% of Lammermuir Festival's budget, and now the future of the festival hangs in the balance as a result. I question the Scottish Government about providing crucial funding to rural cultural projects such as this festival. I was reminded by the Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development that the allocation of grant funding is the responsibility of Creative Scotland. Yet, Presiding Officer, Lammermuir Festival has in previous years partly funded the festival through this grant. Scottish Government cuts to Creative Scotland budget means that difficult decisions such as this one will continue to be made. I was honoured to sponsor a celebration of the major Indian festival, the Shera, last night in the Parliament. Throughout our work to support Scotland's cultural sector, we must continue to make sure that we encourage and invite in Scotland diverse cultures to work towards a vibrant, more inclusive Scotland. That is why I was pleased to hear the Minister's comments last night about the future funding options. Finally, Presiding Officer, it is not simply enough to rescue and support out current cultural institutions. We must ensure that Scotland's cultural sector is protected well into the future. Just a few months ago, Scottish Opera commented on difficulties due to lack of young people in the industry. Arts and cultural jobs and career paths must be made available and promoted in schools alongside more traditional career pathways. Children must have access to music tuition, dance and arts throughout their educational journey. This way we can allow for our cultural sector to continue to survive.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Jamie Green. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by acknowledging that everybody in the Chamber has support for Scotland's culture sector and the fact that it's very important to the economy and our lives, including, of course, in my own constituency of Clackmannanshire and Dunblane. Not only do we have the national cultural highlights like the Japanese Garden in Cowden, about a mile from my house, but also innumerable creative businesses, two independent cinemas, one in Alloa, another at the Microber Arts Centre, which offers a fantastic and wide-ranging cultural and creative programme that goes far beyond simply screening films, as well as many other local creative groups that contribute immensely to public life. I can think of the Dunblane Museum, for example, or the Leighton Library, the first purpose-built library in Scotland in Dunblane. So for that reason, I was very pleased to hear the First Minister's announcement last week that the Scottish Government will more than double investment in Scotland's arts and culture sector with an additional £100 million of funding over the next 5 years, an immense vote of confidence in our culture sector from the Scottish Government. It's merely just a small additional bonus to hear all the whinging from the opposition parties who seem far more concerned about an announcement like that than they were about the culture sector before that announcement. But I would like to pass on my thanks to the Labour Party for taking the time to show their appreciation for the commitment in their motion, which notes the announcement made by the First Minister on the 17th of October to more than double arts and culture funding over the next 5 years. One of many positive announcements from the SNP conference in Aberdeen last week, and I look forward to the Labour Party supporting more of those positive announcements. I mentioned earlier that many creative organisations across my constituency in the culture sector, and I think in our politics and in our society, we can often be guilty of underestimating the value of culture and the arts, the purely economic value that we know they can contribute. What was always true but became particularly notable during the difficult pandemic was that regardless of any economic input or output from the culture sector, culture and the arts is an essential part of the human experience, and it's essential that as a Parliament we recognise that. While funding is extremely important for the culture sector, I would note there are bigger picture constitutional considerations when it comes to Scotland's culture and arts sector, which have not been mentioned in this motion. One of the greatest upsets of Scotland's culture and arts sector in recent years has been the changes that Brexit has meant for Scottish artists. I know that the Tories tried to mention it, so we don't mention it because they hate to have it mentioned. But the artists know this to be the case, especially those seeking to tour and sell merchandise in the EU. And I'm aware that some progress has been made on this. Any agreement, though, that the UK has with the EU or individual member states is absolutely no replacement for the freedom of movement and goods enjoyed by Scottish artists across the continent prior to Brexit. And if we are serious about supporting Scotland's cultural sector, we should be serious about addressing these constitutional issues as well. And I note that Angus Robertson's amendment to this motion rightly makes that clear. I can't think why the Brexit parties don't want to mention it at all, given how important it is to the sector. Another way that Scotland promotes our distinct culture and arts offerings through the Scottish Government's international presence, and while I note that the Labour Party has been supportive of Scotland's international ambitions in the past, the recent muscular unionism on display from the Labour Party indicates that they'd fall in line behind the Tories to quell Scotland's international voice, given the chance to do so. And I'd argue, therefore, it's very telling the Labour Party have chosen to omit any mention of any constitutional issue from this motion. So while the SNP government is taking action to support Scotland's culture, and I should say I very much welcome the announcement that's been made by the government by doubling funding over the next 5 years, it's also clear that the current constitutional arrangement does Scotland's culture and arts sector an immense disservice. And I'd urge everybody in the chamber to consider this when making decisions on how best to support Scotland's culture and arts sector going forward, and I support the motion in the government's name.
Thank you, Mr Brown. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I saw a social meme post this morning on Facebook. Clearly my phone is listening to everything I say in my office these days. The meme simply said, art should disturb the comfortable and comfort the disturbed. Well, what do I mean by that? That's going to be the theme of my short contribution today, because I hope that today's debate does make the government front bench somewhat uncomfortable. Not by anything that we've said so far in the debate, but the fact that today's debate spurred so much contact from so many individuals and organisations in the cultural sector, asking us to speak up for culture in Scotland, I think leads me to believe that this debate is entirely necessary. My own region isn't perhaps blessed with some of the blockbuster-sized and blockbuster-budgeted events such as the Fringe or the Majestic V&A, but it is our local culture and art which is just as, if not even more, important than what happens in our capital and what happens in the Central Belt cities. Yes, Murrayfield and the Hydro can attract Taylor Swift, but it is Greenock that attracts the Taylor Swift Tribute Act, which is a bestseller. Matilda the Musical will be gracing the presence of the Playhouse in Edinburgh, but it is Matilda by young people in the Prominence Academy in Inverclyde which actually makes me more proud to attract. Edinburgh's Botanic Gardens is putting on a wonderful Halloween trail display, but it is Greenock's Galoshians Festival which inspires people in my own community and neighbourhood to dress up and have fun. They say all politics is local, but I'd say all culture is local as well, and that is the theme of my contribution today, because the sad reality is that nearly half of the organisations that are regularly funded by Creative Scotland are now deemed to be in a financially weak position. And that's no surprise, I say, to the Minister on the front bench, because Creative Scotland's core cash budget fell by £13 million from 2010 to 2022. Those are Spice's own analytical figures of the budget. And it is those who are struggling most, like those local theatre groups, like those local youth theatres or creative arts groups or drama groups, doing what they can in spite of the fierce financial pressures that they face. What I would say to the government that to overtly or even inadvertently preside over demise of local culture is a legacy that any minister would want to avoid and must avoid. Let's bear in mind, of course, that many of these projects are funded through local authorities. And we all know the precarious state of local authority funding. That's not to get into that argument today, but goodness knows what the council tax freeze that's been announced by the First Minister will have on local authorities' budgets, particularly on their culture budgets. Because whether we like it or not, it is often culture which is the first thing to be dropped when we're in tough financial times. I also said that art comforts the disturbed. Now, that's not necessarily the disturbed or the deranged, but the value of art and music and culture cannot be measured in pounds and pence. It has much deeper value. There are calls for 1% of the Scotland Government's budget to be spent on culture and arts. And that seems like a big ask in numerical terms. I understand that. But the return on that investment surely is much higher. For a sector that contributes 4% of Scotland's GDP, the ROI on that seems to be immense. Governments the world over, I'm afraid, are guilty of the same thing, and that's that fatal error that culture always seems to suffer first and suffer the most in tough financial times, because funding a youth theatre group or a community orchestra is nowhere near as sexy or headline-grabbing as using that same money to fund a pay rise for nurses or teachers. But it's not just cash that they need, it's certainty, and it's long-term certainty at that, because that certainty will bring about the sort of self-confidence that saw Glasgow put a bid in for the Eurovision Song Contest. And it's that sort of self-confidence that we need to see from the sector. That starts here, and that starts from this government.
Thank you, Mr Green. And I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Claire Adamson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to thank Labour for using their time to debate the plight of the cultural sector in Scotland. It is, of course, a privilege to sit on the SEAC committee and be given the opportunity to learn from an incredible array of cultural organisations and artists every week. And what's clear to me is that many of these bodies are real anchor organisations in their own communities. They are the spaces where artists get opportunities for paid creative work that otherwise simply would not exist. They're the spaces where pipelines of talent are nurtured from the grassroots up. And they're places where mental health and well-being can be nurtured and where communities can come together to educate and to organise. And during the depths of the COVID crisis, it was often cultural organisations like Creative Stirling who helped communities look after each other. Whether it was opening safe spaces when others were closing them down or delivering core services such as food larders, these organisations were central to supporting and galvanising action. So Scotland's cultural sector is not just an economic generator. It's about life, creativity and community. Now, I'd hoped in this debate that we could all agree that COVID's impact on the economy, coupled with Brexit and the cost of living crisis, has now helped to create a perfect storm for the cultural sector. And that funding outlook was already challenging. But in this environment, a small change in public funding can have a disproportionate impact on delivery. Some organisations are already stuck with what's been called donut funding, where project delivery costs are funded but the core running costs are missing. So I do understand why many in the cultural sector have been concerned about recent changes to Creative Scotland's funding from the Scottish Government and what this may mean for funded organisations. However, the Cabinet Secretary has confirmed that the £6.6 million will be paid to Creative Scotland in the upcoming financial year, meaning that the reserves used within this financial year will be replenished by the Scottish Government. But of course, this does not mean that everything is fixed. The long-term future for cultural funding remains challenging. The funding settlement given to the Scottish Government from Westminster does not keep pace with inflation and is forcing difficult choices. We must find a way forward that provides the financial security and certainty that our cultural sector deserves. So I'm pleased the First Minister has made the commitment to double cultural funding. Like many members, I look forward to examining the detail of that in the forthcoming budget. But we now need to take that opportunity to radically rethink the way the sector is funded to secure a future for it and its workers. We need to see a long-term strategy for culture that pivots away from stop-start funding towards multi-year budgets, a strategy which values the wider benefits that culture brings, including through preventative spending, as well as creative use of the transient visitor levy at local level. A strategy co-produced with the cultural sector, reflecting calls from artists' unions for fair work conditionality on arts funding to value, protect and grow the workforce while attracting even more talent. And a strategy that encourages the big culture sector to support its grassroots, whether that's through a levy on stadium tickets or through screen companies giving back to communities who host big budget productions. Presiding Officer, cultural organisations have shown the incredible value that they deliver. It's time for government to help reset its relationship with the sector, build on trust and allow it to thrive.
Thank you, Mr Ruskell. And we now come to the final speaker in the open debate, Claire Adamson. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm going to say that this is a reasonable motion, very reasonable motion, up to a point. It is very reasonable that we are collectively recognising across the Chamber today by many local examples the great contribution arts and culture bring to Scotland's life. It's been reasonable to note the £4.5 billion value to our economy and the 80,000 jobs supported. It's reasonable to mention the perfect storm, a phrase from our committee report work. Reasonable to recognise COVID, the impact it has had on our cultural sector. Reasonable to mention Brexit and the impact on our touring artists. Unreasonable to talk about the cost of living crisis and the fuel costs that have affected our place-based cultural organisations. COVID and Brexit and the cost of living crisis have played their part, and the support from this government has been highlighted also by Mr Gibson. And it has been highlighted by the SEAC committee in our budget scrutiny work. However, and here is where reason leaves the Labour argument, if you come to this chamber demanding that money be restored to that budget, where is that money coming from?
Neil Bibby.
An intervention from Mr Bibby.
The Cabinet Secretary gave a clear promise in February to restore £6.6 million and then did a U-turn. It's actually the Scottish Government's problem. You need to deliver on your promises.
Through the Chair, Claire Adamson.
It came to our committee. The Cabinet Secretary explained what the pressures have been in year on the Scottish Government's budget. He explained about the settlements for pay across different portfolio areas. He talked about the increased costs as a result of trashing of our economy and the impact that has had on all organisations, including this. And remind members that we're the only place that didn't have a junior doctor strike because we were able to settle that. Now, we had a debate this afternoon on skills from Labour as well. So skills coming from our colleges. And within that, we heard calls for more modern apprenticeships to settle the college pay disputes to bring more money here. But we live in a fixed budget, so it's not reasonable to come and say that that money should be put back into this portfolio in this year without saying where you're going to take that money from, because the money that this government has is being spent across portfolios to the benefit of the Scottish people. We also heard the Cabinet Secretary say he has made an argument against things like major events. So people have said, where are the budget areas? Nobody's talked about major events. So UCI came in within this budget portfolio this year. And he's made the argument that going forward, where there are budgetary pressures from like major events in Scotland, that that should be spread across the portfolios and not fall on what has already been said is the smallest budget within the Scottish Government portfolio. So we should support our arts. We are supporting our arts. In fact, the funding that the Scottish Government have given to fill the gap from lottery funding, a commitment that was made for 3 years, has been given by the Scottish Government over 5 years. £33 million over 5 years to fill that gap. This year, they've been asked to use the reserves in Creative Scotland at no detriment to any regularly funded organisation. So when you come to this chamber, I will work with anyone with a reasonable argument about supporting our culture if they come with where is the money coming from.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. We move to closing speeches and I call first Maurice Golden up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I agree with the sentiments made by a number of colleagues today, that it is extremely disappointing to see this SNP government continue their deprioritisation of culture through their deep and enduring real terms cuts in funding to the sector. At this time, when they are faced with the perfect storm of recovering from the pandemic, the cost of living crisis and wage inflation, one third are at risk of insolvency, as pointed out by Pauline McNeill, also highlighted by Faisal Chowdhury. The SNP have turned the screw on the sector by reimposing a 10% reduction in the Creative Scotland budget. If Creative Scotland hadn't found this money from their now depleted reserves, it would have amounted to a 40% reduction in their upcoming quarterly payments to regularly funded organisations. These are organisations that, as highlighted in Neil Bibby's motion and during this debate, are already at breaking point. Neil Bibby pointed out, a promise is a promise and it must be kept. Yep. Alex Cole-Hamilton stated that to dismiss the importance of the arts and culture, we do that at our peril. Jamie Halkrell-Johnson, in an entertaining and insightful speech, said culture helps us reflect on who we are, where we've been, and where we hope to be. Jamie Green spoke about his region and the importance of local arts and culture, including a Taylor Swift tribute act in Greenock. I only wish I still represented the west of Scotland. I might pop along. But I echo the point made by many today. Within weeks of the announcement to break a promise and slash Creative Scotland's budget, the First Minister then stands in front of his conference and makes another promise that he will double the culture budget within 5 years. They won't be in government in 5 years, but yes, happy to take
Keith
an intervention.
Brown.
Okay, Maurice Golan for taking the intervention. I wonder if he would acknowledge, if he thinks that 13 years of austerity economics from the Tories have had any impact on public services in Scotland, and also if he can point to one instance in the last 16 years when the Tory party proposed an amendment seeking more funding for culture in this Parliament.
Maurice Golan.
When I was covering the culture budget, I made many proposals, including an arts bill which would secure long-term funding for Scottish arts and culture, and that's something I fundamentally agree with. But if the First Minister is serious about supporting the sector rather than making new promises, he could start by not breaking the existing ones. We've heard this quote numerous times, but it is worth repeating. The CEO of Creative Scotland said in response to the cut, "It will deepen the concern within the sector about support for culture. It's an erosion of faith and trust." The First Minister should reflect on this, because with the culture sector's faith and trust in the Scottish Government lost, does he think anyone will believe him when he announces long-term support while almost simultaneously reneging on budget promises on a whim? Deputy Presiding Officer, we on these benches are fully supportive of Labour's motion today. Our culture sector is too important. The economic benefits are massive in terms of creating jobs and promoting tourism. And there's less tangible benefits in addition to that. As my colleague Alexander Stewart pointed out in his speech and amendment today, warm words from the First Minister are not enough. We need firm commitments, including sustainable long-term funding model, which will provide multi-year certainty to the sector.
Thank you very much, Mr. Golden. I now call the Minister to wind up again, up to 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I would first like to thank my various colleagues from across the Chamber for their contributions today. And amongst it all, there was some joy and much to be proud of. And I'm very pleased that we have had the opportunity this afternoon to discuss the Scottish Government's continued commitment to culture. Jamie Green asked us to be uncomfortable. I'm sure the Brexit parties here today are uncomfortable. Well, I hope they are. Much of the perfect storm the sector is weathering was in fact created by UK Government policy, and I've heard directly from stakeholders across Scotland about the challenges posed by Brexit. This was also highlighted by the conversations that Keith Brown said he's had too. Leaving the EU has taken away our important structures that supported the Scottish culture sector's international relationships. The Creative Europe programme, mentioned by Kenny Gibson, for example, was a valuable resource for Scotland's culture sector. It provided funding, but most importantly supported the development of connections with peers across the EU. It is a scheme that cannot be replaced through domestic alternatives. And moreover, our ability to respond to these impacts, never mind the cost crisis, is limited by the inactivity of the UK Government and the financial restrictions of devolution. Even in Scotland, the Scottish Tories suggest in their amendment that we should support their art bill, a promise in their manifesto in 2021, like many more of their bill proposals from the Tories, we are yet to see it. A promise is a promise, I think they said. I can reassure Parliament that our long-term recovery plans will look to address challenges collaboratively and strategically in order to secure a more stable, sustainable future for the culture sector and those whose livelihoods and well-being rely on it. That's why I welcome the First Minister's announcement. This work is already underway, and as the Cabinet Secretary said, we are working with the sector on our approach, and we are happy to work with anyone on that approach too. Presiding officer, tomorrow I am meeting with the trade union representatives and hearing their thoughts on art and culture funding. Our conversations will continue. And I am more than happy, as the Cabinet Secretary says, to discuss fair funding measures called for by Kenny Gibson and other MSPs in the Chamber today. Additionally, I am pleased that the culture conveners are meeting again in response to actions developed under our culture strategy. This is welcome as we collectively seek to address the pressing issues that we face. And Jamie Green mentioned Inverclyde in the area that he represents. I had the great honour to visit Inverclyde Culture Collective recently and saw how our local authorities, our culture sector and, more importantly, our communities are working with them to create wonderful opportunities, a great example. So along with COSLA, Spokesperson for Community and Wellbeing, Councillor Maureen Chalmers, I co-chair that group. We are working with the culture conveners on how local and national organisations can work together to support and promote culture, and I would hope that members in here would do the same. This includes exploring and discussing the provision of cultural services and the impact of the cost crisis, the pandemic, and Brexit, as well as an accessible recovery, all highlighted eloquently by Claire Adamson. To fully harness this potential, it is clear that we need to collaborate strategically across central and local government, using all of these lessons, levers and comparative advantage, and we can bring all
the
of
Minister
these to the
table. The Minister is about to conclude.
A number of MSPs today asked about screen machine, so I can give Kenny Gibson, Alec Colham and others an update on that. The Scottish Government is engaging with Screen Scotland to explore all avenues for supporting the future of screen machine. The Cabinet Secretary met with the regional Screen Scotland to hear directly about the machine and the support that it needs, and that meeting was on the 5th of October. So we're continuing that work too. And on our culture strategy, like the wonderful Deshera event that I attended last night, hosted by Faisal Chowdhury, we are a nation that cherishes culture for its empowering, strengthening and transformative power, as underlined in our culture strategy for Scotland. We will publish a refreshed culture strategy action plan in the coming months. The action plan, developed with close engagement with the sector, will respond to these challenges. And can I just make the point about Creative Scotland?
Very briefly, please,
Claire
Minister.
Adamson, just come to an end. Claire Adamson reminded us that we provided Creative Scotland with over £33 million over 5 years to compensate for generally reducing lottery funding. We now face the difficult decisions about government funding.
Thank you, Minister.
The time is right for Creative Scotland
I must
to
ask
draw
you to conclude.
Those on those.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you very much. And I call on Sarah Boyack to wind up. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have to say that in closing this debate for Scottish Labour, I do feel like I've gone back in time, because this is exactly the same debate we were having last year about the proposed cuts to the Creative Scotland budget that would have had a huge impact on the sector facing the perfect storm. And that our motion is absolutely clear, and it's so good to hear across the chamber from members accepting that the creative sector makes a huge contribution to our Scottish economy, because culture is part of who we are as a country. And I know in my own region the impact of the Edinburgh festivals, but I would say to folk that it's got a global reach across the globe, creates jobs and opportunities to access culture on people's doorsteps, but there's still the issue for many people who live in our area who find it hard to afford to go to the Edinburgh festivals. So we've got to make our culture affordable across the country. And that's why we've worked so hard as Scottish Labour to work with the sector, because the challenge of uncertainty of annual funding has had huge impacts on the sector, because putting on cultural events needs long-term planning and it needs commitment to be successful, not in-year budget cuts and not vague promises. Last year, the evidence sessions at the CEAC committee were powerful, and John Layton summed it up by saying the challenge was keeping the lights on and the doors opened. So for me, it's absolutely heartbreaking to hear about this year's evidence to the committee that Neil Bibby quoted in his speech. It's powerful because the sector is facing the same challenges, and they've been worried that they're going to get more cuts. Organisations like Culture Counts, the trade unions, have done a fantastic job in standing up for their members and our communities by making the case for investing in culture. Now, it's important that we don't just have the SNP government talking about culture. Warm words won't cut it. We need to see the evidence. And that's why we've asked again and again, OK, when is the £100 million going to be allocated? How is it going to be spent? Because the point is, we've had 2 years where cuts have been proposed in the budget and we've got potential U-turns. And that is the last thing that our culture sector needs. If you're going to give us the detail as to exactly how you're going to spend it, even in this year's budget, that would be a step forward.
Through the chair, please, Minister.
Thank you very much for taking the intervention. I know time is tight, so I'll be quick. The draft budget will be proposed to this Parliament on the 19th of December, so I welcome your involvement in that.
Sarah Boyack.
That, again, does not clarify the issue about this year's budget. Yep. At all. So those creative organisations are waiting and praying that they're going to get the resources. I know in Edinburgh, it's been mentioned by both Alex Cole-Hamilton and Faisal Chowdhury, we've got a fundraising campaign by the Film House team.
Ms Boyack, could you just give me a moment? Could I just ask colleagues to cease conversations while Ms Boyack is speaking? Please continue.
Thanks, Convener. I shouldn't just have to shout. They've got 2 weeks to go to meet the fundraising target they've set, and they've done phenomenally well. But again, it's about uncertainty. And the comments that have been made today about the Scottish Government proposing to use Creative Scotland's reserves, that is a huge reversal of an approach, because the whole point of reserves is that they're meant to be there for crisis situations. And isn't it an irony that that is exactly what the Scottish Government has itself created? We know that we've got a cost of living crisis. We know we've got the challenge that followed on from the Brexit vote. We know we've got those challenges. The Scottish Government needs to address them. It doesn't need to do year-on-year U-turns and cuts to Creative Scotland's budgets. That just only this week, National Museums warned that it is a struggle for survival. The National Museums, a nationally funded organisation. Now, the National Performing Companies have been mentioned several times. Their budget has been frozen since financial year 2016-17. That is how bad things are. So, yes, we note the £100 million that has been suggested, but we haven't been told in either of the government speeches how that figure is arrived at, how it will happen, how it will be distributed, how we'll see the decent funding for our local authorities. Discussions are ongoing, but as we saw recently, the Verity House Agreement is not exactly respected in detail. How do we know that every school in Scotland is going to have the music tuition, the arts and the dancing teaching that every young person should be able to access? We need the funding. And if the Scottish Government was serious about it, we'd have heard about that today. But as ever, no certainty. And it's particularly disappointing that we didn't get that clarified. I'd be very interested to hear the detail about Alexander Stewart's for an arts bill. But as was commented, we've heard about this bill for some time, so we'd like to see the detail. In closing, Presiding Officer, I do hope that colleagues across the Chamber will do the right thing and call on the Scottish Government to reverse the proposed 10% budget cut to Creative Scotland with immediate effect, to set out in detail how it intends to increase the arts and culture budget, because the timescales are critical for organisations that have to invest in staff. And as Polly McNeill says, fair terms and conditions, longer contracts, that means a longer term financial commitment. If you're putting on shows in 2 years' time, you need to know that you're going to have the money. So let's come together, let's support our motion, and let's have a refreshed strategy that's actually funded properly. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and that concludes the debate on supporting Scotland's culture sector. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 10950 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business motion, a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. And the question is that motion 10950 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of 5 Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 10951 to 10953 on approval of SSIs, 10954 on designation of a lead committee, and 10960 on suspension of standing orders.
Every single one moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of motion 10913 on approval of an SSI. And I call on Shirley-Ann Somerville to move the motion, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are 8 questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Graham Day is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser will fall. The first question is that Amendment 10922.2, in the name of Graham Day, which seeks to amend Motion 10922, in the name of Daniel Johnson, on ensuring Scotland's skills system is fit for the future, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.